with me in the studio today from Gaming Realms, I've got Philip Tuck. Philip, good morning.
Good morning.
Look, since we last caught up with Gaming Realms, you've sold off the majority of your real money casino brands. Of course, a significant chunk of your revenues here. Sold off to River Eye Gaming. Talk me through the thinking, the strategy behind this decision.
So, in terms of the sort of overall capital allocation of the business, we were making a lot of inroads within game design and the kind of broader, I guess, B2B elements of both building games and also our gaming platform. And as a result, we kind of felt it was better to move more capital into those areas. Of course, with the real money gaming business, particularly UK focused, it's a very marketing intensive business. And obviously, as a result, moving that money into the marketing, we sort probably had a lower ROI for the future of the business than into these other parts. That being said, the structure for this for the sale is a kind of classic joint venture. We still have an enormous stake in it and desire to kind of keep it moving and keep it kind of growing. The deal is structured to have a lot of subsequent earnouts. It's a very sort of performance related deal as well. So hopefully it's not a kind of clean break. I think we'll be doing a lot of work across both as we go forward.
Well, tell me a bit about Slingo, because this of course was left out of this deal here with River Eye Gaming.
So Slingo, so Gaming Realms as a whole was born as a company that was trying to produce kind of next generation mobile gambling content. Within the mobile space within gaming, there's a lot of areas that were very easy, quick wins for companies, particularly sports betting and casino. A casino is a very singular experience. You just pop up a roulette wheel. There's not much going on outside it. And sports betting, it's more like an Amazon style shop. You just got lots of prices. It's more of a kind of search problem, but identifying it. But the socialer, if that's a word, games, poker and bingo had much more problems with this, particularly bingo. Like bingo was using a lot of space on the desktop browser.
Right.
There's a lot going on. You know, you've got a chat box, you've got the actual bingo thing going on. Lots of people would play slots at the same time. Very similar problem actually to desktop advertising versus mobile advertising. It's just this kind of screen space problem in effect. You just don't have enough room. And so that was a kind of key problem we were trying to address. The other thing is modern bingo had a lot of problems within it that we also thought weren't quite appropriate for kind of what millennial customers were looking for. If you think bingo has a very flat pay table, generally only has a couple of prizes, it's still very based on the old kind of bingo hall experience. It doesn't have any prizes within the game structure, so it's very flat. If nothing happens, if you don't win, nothing really happens to you, which again is a kind of poor gambling experience relative to kind of most things that are happening within modern gaming. It's also very, very ill-suited to the constant stop and start of mobile play. You know, the world of mobile, of any game, is one of quick breaks, train journeys. You know, it's not the era of kind of sitting at home on your desktop PC, watching TV and playing something for 4 or 5 hours doesn't seem to appeal to this generation like it did to the people who are doing this. And you can imagine in a sort of, you know, bingo schedule where it's a game every 3, 4, 5 minutes. You know, you could be waiting for a game the entire time that you'd want to be playing. And so the kind of key part of addressing that, that is definitely an area that we thought was you had to address or it would fail. One of the other final kind of key difficult things with bingo, and to a lesser extent with sports betting, although sports betting covered it in other ways, is you can't keep going. So if you're playing bingo and you're filling up your grid and you get near, you know, your lucky numbers are left, the game just ends and the state is just over. There's no kind of way for you to carry on playing like you would say, like in-play sports betting. You know, like you have a bet and your team goes 1-0 down, you have a range of choices that you can then subsequently keep interacting with. And that's been a huge, you know, you can see the explosion of in-play sports betting within millennials. It's very related to this, I'm sure. Final thing I'll touch on with bingo is it's just not at all skilled. There's no element of player choice in it. If you think of the old school land-based bingo, had one clear skill element, which is you had to actually dab the numbers. And you had people who'd play 20-30 cards. You know, see these incredible scenes of people able to do 20 or 30 cards perfectly at once. And of course, that's a skill. You know, it's not something I couldn't do. I couldn't go into a bingo hall and whack off 20-30 cards. It's not doable. Whereas online bingo, it's all auto-marked. And so you're kind of just sitting there watching this thing happening. And again, with the rise of these kind of social skilled games, something like Candy Crush, where you're making actual decisions with it, poker, in-play sports betting, again, they have a large skill element. And so we also kind of wanted to build a game which catered to that, which hopefully, and kind of go through it in shortly, but hopefully go through how this kind of works within the Slingo game. But that's roughly what kind of led us to it as a production.
Right. So, but with some of those issues, some of those obstacles in mind, let's take a look at Slingo and talk through some of the measures that you've taken to overcome some of these. Let's take a look.
Yeah, sure. First thing to note is this pay table changing on the left. So unlike bingo, where you just go into a game, it's the same cost. This behaves much more like a regular slot where you can change the stakes. You can see bottom left, it's now at £3, but you could have it at £1, £2. Mm-hmm. And so that rattles through, which again, caters to people in both directions. So it caters to very micro stakes players in that you can just play it for 20 or 30p. And it also caters to people who want to bet a lot more. Then within it, we can just pause it quickly. So the way the game is structured is how much like a bingo card. So you have the classic 5x5, but instead of having one number being called, you have five along the bottom. Mm-hmm. You'll also notice on the left that the way the pay table is constructed, there's a lot more depth to it than a classic bingo game prize, where you basically just have a full house and sometimes a couple of others at the top. But here you've got things much more like modern slots, where, for example, here you're betting £1, but you only break even after four line wins. So you have wins that are smaller than your initial stake. So it's not a, there's some reward to it, e.g. you're not just losing everything, but it's still not a winning experience. The way the game's structured is you're just trying to fill this out across the number of spins you have. So on the right, you can see you have 11 spins. You have lots of little additional features. So here we just had a free spin come in. You can see that goes up, so now you've got that to go later. If you can just pause it quickly here. So you can see that the normal numbers have come in. So you can see 18 and 48 have hit, just like they would in bingo.
Right.
But we also added what we call jokers, which are effectively wildcard choices. And these can be, there's two types of them. This is the regular one, and it can be placed anywhere within the column above it. So this is where, effectively where the skill element becomes, because different parts of the board are worth different things because they complete different number of lines. For example, a corner is more valuable than the standard part of the edge. The middle square, so 38 in this case, is worth a lot more than any of the others. And then you also have some nasty trade-offs as the game develops. So it might be that you can make one line, but you might be better off making a corner that doesn't make you an immediate prize, but potentially makes you a prize further down the road. So it's got a lot kind of richer skill element than bingo would have. And obviously this isn't possible in bingo, because in bingo it's all being played against people, so you don't have the time. Whereas you could, right. So you could spend a while thinking about this if we continue. And so here you can see you can place it on any of these in the end, take the bottom right corner. So it's just a normal spin, nothing of interest has come in on that one. Right, so if we can just pause it again quickly. So this is, there's also sub prizes for if you hit numbers of jokers. So if you hit three or more jokers, it guarantees you a small win. So in this case, you can see at the top, it's you win 50p, as well as allowing you to then place them. So you can have very correlated wins, in that you can have lots of wins from these, but also they're very powerful symbols in that they're allowing you to place them anywhere. So if you continue the video, please. So yeah, you see this is a joker bonus. And then these can be placed anywhere.
You're pretty confident you got the recipe for success here.
Yeah, so as the game develops, it has another kind of interesting part, like bingo, of creating a lot of near misses. Yeah, so this is a super joker. This can be placed anywhere. You can see it from its green. Continue. So again, another standard joker. And so here you can see you've got the first line win. So you've got five in a row and that comes in. And another one from 46. So you can see as you're building the card up, you're getting very, very close and you don't need that many additional numbers to immediately get into the very large prizes, which is, you're always kind of very near a big win in the game, depending in the final couple of spins, there's always a lot. It's much like a football game, you know, the last kind of 5-10 minutes are always quite
building
tense.
Building that excitement.
Yeah, so if you just pause it here. So the final, so we've used up all the spins here. That are available to us. It's been quite a good game. So we've got six lines, we've won £4 to £1 stake. And at this point, you can either collect your £4 or it turns effectively into like an in-play sports betting environment where you have a bid, so the spin for £5.01, and you have the three remaining numbers. So if you, you know, if your lucky lottery numbers involve 8, 30 and 47, this enables you to keep going. These bids, they range in value dramatically from very low, if the grid is very, not much has happened, you can keep playing for 1 or 2p to very high, you know, if you need one number. It's exactly like an in-play sport, you know, if your team's 5-0 up, the price you have to pay to back them becomes very, very different. But yeah, so in terms of what it covers off in those of the kind of previously discussed points, it's very quick and easy to start a game. You're not relying on waiting for people. It's got a much deeper pay table. It's got a lot of in-game wins, which you just never get in bingo, and it's got a lot more flexibility for the player at the end of the game.
And what kind of feedback have you had from people using it, trying it out?
Yeah, so the player feedback on it, from a kind of qualitative point of view, you know, in focus groups, there are lots of people who like it and talk a lot about it, how it's a kind of nice bridge between bingo and slots. And in terms of the data that we just get from players, you know, we offer a lot of slots on our B2C businesses and they outperform. So these games outperform everything available to us by a very high degree. They like to keep people playing longer. People spend more when they're playing them. And they tend to be stickier long-term customers. So the churn is reduced as well on them. So yes, so far it seems to be, performing well.
Performing well. And of course you've got the significant licensing deal with GVC.
Yeah, so obviously getting these games, so, you know, building the games is fine, but if you can't distribute them to a large number of partners, it's all a bit moot. So GVC is a important deal because they're a very wide and very large company. It encompasses Ladbrokes, Coral, lots of very big names would sit within them. And obviously if we can get those games out, we started to see even dedicated tabs to Slingo on some of these sites where they'll specifically have it as its own game genre. And obviously in that situation, if you can get kind of that type of coverage at that type of scale, you can kind of, you can see why we would consider it something so worthy of investment, if that makes sense, compared to carrying on putting more marketing budget into our B2C brands.
Hey, Philip, look, it's been brilliant to have the chance to meet you and giving us that demo, that run through. Really nice to have the chance. Thanks very much.
Thank you.